everybody. Thank you for tuning in for this session about crowd management for smart cities. In this session, we will discuss about how cities can use the power of video to manage crowds. My name is Roy Band. I'm community manager at Milestone Systems, and I will take you through the discussion about managing crowds for smart cities. So what are the major goals for a smart city, and why is crowd management so important for a smart city? Well, basically, we can identify five main goals for a smart city. One is to drive efficiency, service efficiency, making sure public resources are managed and used optimally. Second, of course, is sustainability, so improving the quality of life while reducing the environmental impact. Three is about mobility, so citizens need to be able to travel and move freely and without friction through a city. Fourth is about, of course, safety and security, so keeping neighborhoods, but also public spaces safe during events, daily life, or maybe even emergencies. The fifth one is about an economic growth. And as you know, all cities want to be attractive to companies and investors to build their businesses into their cities to create jobs, for example. Managing crowds touches upon many of these earlier mentioned topics like mobility, safety and security, economics. And this is why crowd management is so important to have, because in this way a city can understand but also redirect and inform citizens about the current situation. So let's talk about managing crowds for a minute. As we all know, and as a lot of studies already show, cities are continuously growing due to urbanization. By 2050, 70% of all world's population already lives inside cities. But what the recent pandemic also taught us is that how important it is to manage crowds in order to keep them safe for both health and safety reasons. Crowd management is the ability to monitor and direct groups of people to ensure the safety, but also to increase the quality of life for our citizens, to increase experiences for tourists and visitors if they were to visit a football match or a baseball match or even a concert. Now, crowd management can be applied to a couple of things: people on foot, people in public transportation, but also traffic and monitoring traffic. Crowd management systems provide stakeholders with real-time and historical data about how people move through a city in order to provide the best quality services and the highest levels of safety. So according to some studies about crowd management solutions are moving away from video solutions to mobile solutions offered by telecom service provider because of a cost consideration. However, with modern video technology and deep learning technology, video systems are able to extract extremely valuable data from video for a smart city compared to a couple of years ago, providing superior or at least complementary data for analytics and real-time city information. Commonly used technologies today are sensor-led, meaning mobile IoT devices like Bluetooth beacons or IP cameras like today, wearable devices like RFID bracelets for high-density situations, device-led solutions, so mobile phone tracking GPS positions and stuff like that, mobile networks, 4G, 5G monitoring devices of which are using the LTE network to provide the data for these cities. And technologies can even be combined to create an even more accurate data about crowds. So one of the big questions is, what can the power of video do today to make cities smart, or at least to help cities to become smart? Well, today, the power of video can do a couple of great things already. Like, for example, measure crowd sizes, or to do crowd counting, to put an exact number on a crowd of people. It can measure crowd density to see if a crowd is big or small and react upon it. It can monitor crowd behavior, for example, for speed or brawling, etc. It can do whitelisting, it can do blacklisting of persons or individuals, or it can do person of interest search to find and look for missing people. So it can already do a lot of great stuff. Now today, I want to take you to our technology partners who can do an introduction about crowd management and crowd behavior. Now for this first session, I'm here together with Enrico Montagnino from Anyvision. Now Anyvision is a manufacturer of artificial intelligence face recognition solutions, specifically for smart cities. Enrico is here to tell you all about the terrific solution he has to offer and the relevant use cases for crowd management in smart cities. So welcome Enrico, welcome to this session. Can you tell us more about your solution and Anyvision?
Thanks Roy. Over the next few minutes, I'll be talking to you guys about what I call the power of visual AI in smart cities. You know, there are many concepts around that, but specifically today we're going to be talking about face and body, and I'll guide you guys through a little bit of the challenges that we see, the kind of things that we can do to address those challenges, and maybe with enough time we can also give you an insight into what this whole thing looks like. So the challenge, so I'll go from top left down and I'll talk through why we see them as challenges and why customers are telling us that they are challenges. So big challenges is getting access to that video and then having the tools to trawl through hours and hours of video and finding what it is that you're looking for. And it is a big, it is a huge challenge, and you know, it's certainly one that we can address, and I'll go into that in a little bit. The second thing is finding the needle in the haystack. So to find the specific person that you're looking for example, if you've got a photo, or to find someone based on a description, is near on impossible with most traditional technologies, which again, I'll go on to talk you through how we address that. We then go on to the kind of re-identification of individuals, meaning that they may wear a certain item of clothing for one part of their crime and then change clothing for another, you know, another part of the crime. So to pick up those nuances and to be able to stitch together the fact that it's the same person is extremely difficult. We then, as I've touched on earlier, looking at ensuring that the right people get access to the right areas. You know, a smart city is made up of different assets, and all of these environments have the challenge of who accesses them, making sure the right people accessing them. And even as you get into those buildings themselves, ensuring that they only get into certain parts of those areas. And then finally, it's about tracking. Tracking is all about, again, leveraging the assets that you have, meaning the cameras, but being able to use all of those assets, edge devices, and be able to follow that person through, for example, you know, a city, so you can actually look at where that person's gone to, you know, look at exactly what he or she did, where they're going, where they've been, and so on. So these are the challenges that we see today in talking to most of our customers within this domain. So what is the solution? What do we do as Anyvision? So I'll take the same challenges and I'll talk you through what we do to address them. So firstly is that our platform is designed to take historical data. So we take video that has been already recorded, we can ingest that into our platform, and we can actually run it at 20 times the speed of live to trawl through the video to look for specific people, either based on face and body, so that you can very quickly get to the results that you're looking for, which is what happened, who was involved, etc. In terms of identifying the needle in the haystack, so how do we identify people in a crowd? So the AI part of our platform looks for faces and bodies exactly like you and I would. So for those of you that are not necessarily that technical, if you take a very, very busy scene, you know, the ability to find the face is extremely small. So again, if you have a very busy scene, we can find that person as long as we have, as I said, up to or down to 45 by 45 pixels, which is extremely small. And we'll show some examples later. Same concept goes with body. So if there's a busy scene and we're looking for someone, we don't know who it is, but we have a description, we can take the example, or we can take the descriptions of the clothing, what they, you know, what they're wearing or what they're carrying, put that into the system, and it will look at that scene, regardless of how many people are in there, and extract any you know, footage where a similar description is found. And that's how we identify, you know, the needle in the haystack. We then get into repeat appearances. But because our system has the intelligence to re-identify faces in multiple cameras or scenes, regardless of what they're wearing, we'll be able to tell you that that's the same person. And then finally, which I've kindly touched upon, which is the what I call crudely stitching together the individual. So we can take the same person and we can track them across multiple cameras. I'm now going to go into the how. How do we do that? So our platform is, as I've already mentioned, based on artificial intelligence, which in essence means that we've taught our system to identify face and bodies like the human brain does. It's like us as humans looking through a camera and saying, yep, that's a person, and I know that's a person because we know what a person looks like, or that's a face regardless of whether it's 45 degree angle, side profile, etc. So by teaching this, that's how we've got our system to extremely high accuracy rates and why it works in what we call the wild. Privacy is a very big subject, particularly for us Europeans, and even though I'm talking from the UK, I still consider myself a European. So what we've done as part of our platform is, well, there's two answers to that. One is, from a technical perspective, we have added layers to our platform to, for example, mask individuals that have been recorded, and we'll show you an example of that later. We have added layers of privileges, so only the right people can get access to certain parts of the data. All of the data resides with the client, so we don't store anything ourselves. And I think actually a very good point to talk about our relationship with Milestone. You know, we have a fully integrated platform with Milestone. We have for a number of years. So, you know, leveraging infrastructure is not just cameras that are, you know, screwed onto a wall, but the VMSs that you guys have got from, you know, a great and reputable company like Milestone. Track and trace is something I've already mentioned. So this is ability to not only be able to track people across multiple cameras, which of course in a city is very important because you're covering a wide area, but also to associate people with the individual that you're looking for. And then finally, it's about central command and central observation and alerting, which I think is critical to any form of analytic in a context of a smart city that you have to have. So that's how we address it.
Thanks for your clear explanation, Enrico. Now, we've been talking about contact tracing, and during big events or mass crowds, we know that's a big sign for hooligans, rioters, or maybe pickpockets to show up. And usually those people don't work alone. They work in groups. So I think the contact tracing system you have in your software could be a very useful tool for the police or city managers to identify those people and the ones that are related to each other. Could you maybe demonstrate or show how that would work inside the Anyvision system?
Sure, absolutely. So great question, Roy. And it's obviously very relevant, unfortunately, in this crazy world that we're living in at the moment. So what I'll show you is an extract of a scene of the platform. So, you know, you won't see all obviously the full system, but just a specific part where we show contact tracing. And of course, if you guys want to know more, then we can take it offline. What you see in front of you is the main interface, which is our kind of platform. So on the left hand side here, you have a lady under the title of filter by image. And what we can see straight away is every person that is associated to this lady. Okay. And I can go into any one of these examples. And what it will do is it will automatically extract the video. Again, if this was not if, when it's, if it's a Milestone system, it'll be pulling it from the, you know, the GUI. And again, another example here where I can do exactly the same. And we can, of course, go through as many of these. Again, just to understand and to look, you know, who was this person that was associated to her? How far was the person associated? So in the context of COVID-19, distance is key. But if it was a gang in a railway station, it doesn't necessarily matter about the distance. It's more about the association to ensure that, you know, we've got a some form of a track or a trend. Now, what we can do is we can change the filters here, where we can actually go one step further and say, I want to see not just who was associated with this lady, but the dwell time. So anyone that was with her for a defined period. So here it's between 10 and 30 seconds. You can change that between 1 minute and 5 minutes. So again, if it's COVID-19, it's a couple of minutes. If it's general crime, it's maybe within these seconds. So by changing that, what the system will now do is it will go away and it will look for the associations, but timed. And this is the big win for us. So what you now see here now is in red, everyone that was associated to this lady for longer than a defined minute or a defined time. And what you can do from here is you can go into that video exactly like the example that I showed you, and we can see the extract and association of, you know, what happened. From here, as you can see, we can enroll this particular individual. And really importantly, what the system can now do is it will show you every time that person was captured on any camera within the city. But more importantly, what we'll go on to now is the tracking. So by knowing the person, by enrolling the person onto the system, and I'll just pause that for a second. Just go back a second there and pause it. This shows, this could be a city, this could be a building, the chronological order and the track in which the person took, or the line that the person took. So right, that's just a quick example of showing how the system could address that.
Thanks for the demo, Enrico. Now let's talk about privacy for a minute. We know we use video surveillance in cities, and privacy is of course a big concern for everybody. We've been asked a lot about how to maintain that privacy, and of course we can apply blurring on X-Protect systems, but that's not dynamic. And with face recognition, we can actually identify faces and dynamically blur only the faces, so we can actually guarantee the privacy of the people on the streets. Is that correct?
Exactly right, yeah. As you can see here, we have an extremely busy scene, which is a railway station. And every person that you see that's been masked is a person that the system has identified. So this gives you a real insight into how good the platform is at identifying people in a crowd. Now, the point here is about GDPR. So this is where we can protect the integrity of the person or people that are not part of a search. So what I'll do here, or the example that we have here, and I'll run through the video, is we've got an individual. This individual is the person that we're looking for. He's known. We have his approval to use his face. But in downloading the video, we've masked every other person in the scene. So in other words, we have no way of identifying that person. So I'll just play that video. It's only a short clip. So you can see operationally how it works. And at no point in the scene can we take the picture from any other person. So again, extremely powerful, and two takeaways is how, good the algorithm is in a busy scene, and two, the fact that we can mask individuals' faces once we've downloaded the video itself.
So that already concludes the presentation of our first presenter, Enrico Mantegno from Anyvision. So thank you, Enrico. Let's move on to our next guests, Pat Aiello and Maya Scheer from Viisights. Now, Viisights is a video analytics company focusing on deep learning and artificial intelligence technology, and specifically for behavioral recognition systems for real-time video intelligence. So welcome, Pat. Welcome, Maya. Can you tell us about yourself and about Viisights?
Thank you, Roy. I'm Maya, and Pat is with me. I'm VP of Global Business Development and Sales for Viisights. Pat is the VP of Business Development and Sales for North America. Viisights is a software company. We are a startup company that was established in 2015. Basically, we are providing what we call the next generation of video analytics. And of course, I will explain why we consider it to be the next generation. Our technology is patented and protected. We actually certified 3 patents in the with the US Bureau of Patents. We are utilizing machine learning technology both for inferencing the video and for training the system with more use cases of the predefined behaviors. We are focusing in our business with the security and safety use cases, mostly for public safety verticals like safe and smart cities, safe and smart enterprises. And basically, we know that the next generation, or what we call, the most trending vertical now, is understanding behavior in the video. And by behavior, we mean what kind of motion in the video is happening. We are familiar with two approaches in this area. One approach is all the companies that you are familiar that are offering anomaly detection or abnormal activity. And these companies are utilizing machine learning technology in order to learn a certain routine or normal behavior that is happening in front of the camera. And after a self-training mode, they know to tell you or to alert when something abnormal is happening. We are not using this approach. We are doing something different. We are actually training the system with predefined use cases. We are we already support more than 50 use cases of behavior. So basically, when we come across a demand of the market for a new behavior that is required in order to help security entities to respond in real time, we train the system with videos, and after a certain amount of training, the system can identify and recognize this behavior in real time. And this is why we consider ourselves as the next generation, since we provide a lot of value with the multiple use cases of behavior in real time. So as we mentioned before, we developed new technology that we call video understanding technology. Our task actually is to help those critical or security entities to respond in real time. And basically, our mission is to transform the video from just video footage to actionable insights. The technology is based on two important building blocks. One is understanding behavior. And when we can talk about behavior, we relate to anything that is related to motion in the video. Okay? So basically, we divided this category of behavior or of layer of behavior to three categories, subcategories. One, in our terminology, we call actions, and it describes the activity of every object in the video. For instance, a person running, a person falling, a person throwing an object, a car driving and stopping. Okay, this is the kind of actions that we find in the video. And the second category is called events. And in events, we consider or we relate to everything that is related to interaction between objects, two or more objects. For instance, people fighting. We have the capability to understand and to identify in real time when two or more people are fighting in the video stream. Okay, we also have the capability to identify car accident, car collision, when two cars are colliding one to each other. And the third category of behavior is full understanding and recognizing full scenes in the video. For instance, a crowd behavior that we will show you a few slides from now. The second very important layer when you want to find those events of interest in real time is understanding the context. And of course, we relate to understanding automatically context, which means what kind of location the behavior is happening at. For instance, if we identify or recognize in real time when a car is driving and stopping, we can alert when the car is driving and stopping in the middle of a junction, and it violates the traffic. Or for instance, if we recognize in real time a person loitering, we can push the alert when this loitering motion is happening in front of a school or near an ATM. So this is the kind of contextual information that we also provide. Of course, everything is conducted automatically. As you all know, you have a lot of companies that are engaging in video analytics. Our differentiation is due to the fact that we are processing the video differently from other technologies. And basically, this difference in processing the video is what is enabling us to understand motion in the video. In this example that you see here in this frame, you see that there are two people. And, classic software that you may be familiar with that is analyzing static objects, they won't be able to tell if these humans, these people here in the frame, are hugging or fighting and falling. Only the next frame, understanding the next frame and the relations between these two frames will tell you that this is actually a violence occurrence that you need to respond to. And basically, this is our key differentiator. When we analyze the video, we are analyzing multiple frames, not only one static frame of the video, of the image. We are analyzing a group of between 20 to 30 frames within a sliding window of 3 seconds. And this method, we call it, it's part of our patents. We call it temporal analysis. And this method of analyzing the video, this way to analyze the video is actually what enables us to understand the motion in the video, to find those scenes, events, and action that I mentioned before. And on top of it, of course, we also provide the contextual awareness, and everything is done or conducted with high performance due to the fact that we're using machine learning technology. So here are the use cases for crowd behavior. Pat, would you like to maybe introduce the slides, the videos for the use cases for crowd? Yeah, okay.
In this particular video, we're showing brawl. So as you can see, our system picks up crowd management. It could identify by how many people are in the crowd. So if you want it to be alerted by 10, 20, 30 people, it will send the alert. It will also immediately alert if the crowd breaks into a brawl, which is what you're seeing here. You can see the box around it as well. So as you can see here, the crowd gathers, which is fine. You could be alerted for that, but you can also be alerted if the crowd starts to brawl, which is shoving and pushing and kicking, as you see here. So the system can alert you in two different ways. So this is an example of a crowd running. So you can have a crowd gathering or a crowd dispersing. So this is a perfect example of a crowd running. Immediately the system picks up the crowd running or dispersing, puts a box around it, and sends the alert to the system. You can see it again here, people just running through. This is an example of kind of violent activity. So our system can pick up people throwing items. It can pick up people swinging a bat, throwing a tennis ball, different things like that. When crowds get together, it's fine. But when they become violent like this, whether they're throwing snowballs, Molotov cocktails, whatever you'd like, our system will immediately detect that. So if the behavior changes from the crowd, whether they get together, our system will immediately alert based on what the activity. So it's all based on behavioral activity, as you see here. The system is fine, but once the people start throwing snowballs, it becomes an alert, it becomes an issue, and the police or whoever is alerted to come and take care of the situation. Here is our example of our people density. So you can see here, crowds gathering together, people density, crowds getting very close to each other. More for COVID activities, but also something that'll be something to be noted in the future. So once a crowd gathers, we could also identify what the density of that crowd is. Are they too close? Are they gathering? Is it getting larger? That type of stuff. So it's very useful for concerts, for stadiums, and for different environments like that, campus environments as well.
And with that, we have already come to an end of this video session. I hope you've enjoyed it, and I would like to thank Enrico, I would like to thank Maya, and I would like to thank Pat for contributing to this session. Thank you for watching, and hopefully see you next time during the next session. Bye bye.